are we?
I think we're sitting in the conference room. Put the map down. You're blocking the camera.
Today, we're going to help you navigate the new Power Expert Meter web interface. Last time, we went over some basics with Chris and Ed. If you haven't seen that video, make sure to watch it.
This time, we'll go a little deeper into the navigation, just like the video from last week. This video is applicable to the Power Expert 4, 6, and 8,000 series meters. It'll also work for the Power Expert Multipoint and the Power Expert 2000 series meter once the HTML5 upgrade is released.
Let's roll. In our previous video, we covered the overview tab, so today we'll start on the trends tab.
Here you'll see a few different sections. The first one is meter. You'll find different meter values, graphs, and data tables. You can change which value you're looking at with the drop-downs and the radio buttons on the side.
If you have a different meter, your page might look a little different, but all of them should work the same way.
Moving on to the power section, you'll see that it looks very similar and works the same way.
If you have a power quality meter, you will have a quality section. This one works the same way.
Let's look at the phaser section. You only have one of these if you have a power quality meter.
This looks different,
but it's really easy to use. In the center, you see the phaser diagram of the system you're metering. To make the graph easier to read, you can turn the phasers displayed off by clicking on one of the colored icons in the key.
The little checkboxes next to each quantity do the same thing.
Here we have the energy tab. You can find energy and demand information using the radio buttons on the side.
But here's what makes this one interesting. We can view comparisons in this tab, so let's pick energy comparison in the dropdown.
Now you see, we have two different lines plotted. The black one corresponds with the dates shown over here, and the blue line corresponds with the date given here.
Let's change what's being compared. Use the little white drop-down here, and you'll see we can pick this month with last month.
What if I want to compare two specific dates?
Then you would choose to compare two different weeks or two different months. You can select the date range you want by clicking on the box date and making your selection in the date picker.
I don't know if we mentioned this earlier, but some of the graphs have a button up here. Anytime you see that, you can download the data table as a CSV file. That's cool, but I can top that.
Yeah?
Yep, sure can. For graphs like this one, you might see these buttons with triangles on them. You can use the plain old triangle to slide back and forth through the data set.
What do you think the other button is for?
The triangle with the line? That's if you want to see the beginning or the end of the data set. For example, after you've scrolled back a bit, you can use this button on the right to go back to the future.
Let's talk about the timeline section. Every meter might look a little bit different, but the idea is the same. To start off, we have our list of events on the left-hand side. Above it, you can acknowledge or clear all events.
Well?
Well what?
Aren't you going to clear these events?
No, because this isn't my meter. I'm borrowing it from somebody else. Besides, that's not very interesting.
Do you have a better idea?
Pick out a good event from the list on the left.
How about using the SAG event?
When you click it, you can see details relevant to the event. Using the drop-downs, you can also view waveforms or the RMS for each event as applicable.
Now let's move on to the ITIC curves.
Let's hold off on that one. ITIC curve functionality is only available on the PXM 6000 and above. We'll put that in a special video with details on the PXM 4, 6, 8000 series meters. Let's show the folks at home how to change their meter settings.
Okay, so here's the basics. The setting tab is a skinny black bar at the very top of the screen.
Once you're in the settings screen, clicking on the meter's name in blue at the very top We'll take you back to the metering screens.
I thought you wanted to change the settings on your meter.
I do. I just want to make sure that people knew how to get out of the settings section as well.
The settings section operates under its own set of rules. You see how the parameters you can change are grouped into different tabs? Each of the tabs is then divided into a collapsible section for your viewing convenience.
Let's go ahead and add a trigger.
Do you know what kind of trigger you want to add?
Let's do an out of limits trigger.
Okay, start by clicking on the out of limits section.
Yep.
Don't write me off yet. This is very important. If you want to add an out of limits trigger, but you open up another section when you click on add new trigger, it'll show up in the wrong place.
Oh, we don't want that.
The easiest thing to do is to collapse all the sections, then open out the section you want. In this case, out of limits. Then select add new trigger.
Why is it prompting me to log in again?
If we logged in with the administrative credentials when we started, this wouldn't be an issue. But since we logged in with the lower level account, we need to prove we're allowed to edit the settings on the meter.
Okay, well, I've got an admin account too. Let's log in. Okay, now what?
You can select the parameters you're interested in with the drop downs on the right. But wait, there's more.
You sound like a bad infomercial.
But now you always remember, when you're adding a new trigger, don't forget to open up the trigger itself. See how the arrow next to the trigger, new, is pointing sideways? Click on it to make it point down.
There's more stuff to set up.
That's right. Finish setting up your trigger, then save and close.
What if we want to edit something, like if I wanted to change the meter to a static IP address? That's under comms and Ethernet LAN.
Expand the section and click edit.
Your meter ships with DHCP as the default. If you want to use a specific IP address, select use the following and make the necessary changes below.
Don't forget to scroll back to the top and save.
Side note, if you don't have a specific IP address and you want to stick with DHCP, you can totally do that. You want to connect to the meter locally and come to this section to copy down the IP address. Let's talk about updating firmware.
Why would you need to update your firmware? You already have the latest version.
I'm planning ahead. You know that the engineering team periodically releases updates to their meter firmware. I just want to make sure that our internet friends are ready to receive cool feature enhancements and security updates.
Fair enough. Let's start under General, then expand System and Firmware.
So that's where the upgrade button is.
Browse for your firmware upgrade file.
This should be a zip file that you can get on Eaton.com.
Enter an admin user's name and password and select Start Upgrade.
Then break out a deck of cards while the meter does its thing. When it's finished, close your browser and reopen it to make sure that there's nothing funky getting cached. Then hit up the IP address, come back here, and confirm that the update went through correctly.
So that wraps up our crash course on the new PowerExpert meter web interface. If this was helpful, be sure to hit that like button so we know to make more videos like this one.
But the fun's not over yet. We'll have videos covering features and tabs that are specific to each meter, so be sure to tune in for that.
If you've got any issues or questions, contact Eaton's customer success team. They can help you find what you're looking for. Thanks for choosing Eaton's PowerExpert meters, now with HTML5.
And say hello to the future.